Good evening, everyone. My name is Claire McLean. I am a physical therapist and I'm one of the co-founders of the Neuro Collaborative. Welcome to our Facebook Live. We were off for 2 weeks, so we're excited to be back. And in case this is the first video you have seen, please go and check out our website, iloveneuro.com. Sign up for our newsletter. You'll get emails with updated information. I'll be sending out an email after this Facebook Live with the blog that I will also have posted tonight and a link to the video in case you didn't get a chance to catch the whole thing. And of course, it'll be here on Facebook as well. And then also make sure to like Neuro Collaborative on Facebook. And then we also have a group on Facebook. So please join that closed group. That's a really good place for discussion, questions and answers. And we're definitely checking that out and seeing what's going on in there and also posting some questions to see, you know, what topics everyone's interested in hearing about. So tonight our topic is residencies. So it's a topic that is near and dear to my heart. I did a residency and I highly recommend them. But before I get ahead of myself, in case there is anyone watching this video who either is not a physical therapist and is not familiar with residencies in physical therapy, or if you're a student and it's a new topic to you, residencies in physical therapy are not required like they are in medical school. So physical therapy school is typically about a 3-year program. Almost all of the programs now, I think there's maybe just a last couple who are transitioning to a doctor of physical therapy. And so that 3-year program, for most programs, you graduate as a generalist. So the idea is that you could go and get any job, you know, continue to learn, of course, but start working with people and really be able to help people with most conditions in most situations. And I think the number is high. It's about like 80% of physical therapists end up going on to work in outpatient orthopedic type of settings. And so there they see all types of injuries, people who are post-surgery, maybe some mild balance problems or just older adults. And then also a lot of therapists go to work in hospitals and acute care. So you're helping people get up and out of bed and start moving around after an injury or illness. And these settings especially work if you're more of a generalist and you've had kind of a basic education in all areas of physical therapy. Then a residency in physical therapy is an option if you would like to go and specialize in a certain area of physical therapy. So there are residencies in orthopedics, sports, women's health, geriatrics, pediatrics, neurologic, of course. I'm trying to think of the list that I looked at last night if I'm missing. Oh, cardiovascular and pulmonary. So in many of the different specialty sections of the American Physical Therapy Association, there's the ability to do a residency and then sit for a test where then you are a clinical specialist in that area. So with residencies, probably orthopedic residencies are the ones that have been around the longest, and probably there are the most orthopedic residencies, and then lots of other residencies are getting started. And so this is an area that if you're really interested in specializing in a certain area of physical therapy, it'll take you to that next level in terms of your experience and education. You get mentoring. So if you kind of know that you want to go into one of these areas that probably was covered in school, but you know that there is just so much more to learn, a residency is a really good way to further your education. So different residencies are different in terms of how they're set up. There's always a clinical component. That is probably true for all residencies. But aside from that, there may be differences. And my experiences with the University of Southern California's residency, so that's the one I can really talk the most about in terms of details. For USC's neurologic residency, you're in the clinic about 20 hours per week. Actually 24 hours per week, 20 hours of that week you are treating independently. Of course, there's other clinicians around. And then 4 hours a week was mentoring. And then you took classes, which when we did the residency, which was almost 10 years ago now, it was weekly classes in the evening. Now it has moved to more of a continuing education type of format with 2 long weekends early in the year of education and then ongoing webinars and journal clubs and things like that throughout the year. You also spend time with the neurologists at USC, which is a really wonderful experience. Getting to work with movement disorder specialists or more of the immunology specialists, and that was one of my favorites, definitely. And then you also work on a research project. So you may work on an existing research project, or you may do a case study. There's different options, and it kind of depends on the person coming in to do the residency. If you already have an idea of something that you'd really like to do, maybe a project you've worked on before, or a project that you know is happening at that location. So it's pretty flexible. It's hard to do an entire research project in 1 year. So it's good to work on a project or do some type of case study or something that really is feasible in the course of a year. So that means I can back up and say, so residencies are typically about a year long. And so you fit all of this experience in. It's a huge commitment. And what they say is that doing a residency kind of progresses your career about 5 years forwards in terms of your clinical experience and knowledge. And I would definitely say that that was true for me. So I can speak about my experience. I went to University of Southern California for physical therapy school, and that is definitely a program where you learn a lot about all different aspects of physical therapy and graduate as a generalist. I would say, if anything, there is a little bit more of an orthopedic focus. We have some really excellent clinicians and researchers at USC, so we're really lucky to get a lot of great experience and mentoring. And during PT school, in case you're not a physical therapist, during PT school, then there are clinicals. So at different time points for different lengths of time, you go out and work in the clinic and have mentoring and supervision, and you're doing that along with your program. So at USC, at the time when I went to school, between the 3 years, we had 52 weeks of clinical experience. So almost an entire year of our 3-year program was spent in the clinic. So you do get a lot of hands-on experience. I personally did not get a clinical that was neurologic physical therapy focused. And I realized in my second year of PT school, when we were really focusing on that content more, that that was an area I was really interested in. I did a pediatric clinical, so that there was some overlap with neuro, and I really enjoyed that clinical. But then when I was coming to finishing PT school, I really felt like I was very interested in neurologic PT, and I felt like I still had a lot to learn. And there was a residency at USC. So I have to say, if there wasn't a residency there, I don't know for sure. If I'd gone somewhere else for school that didn't have one, I don't know if I would have sought that out myself or even known that that existed at the time. When I did the residency, I think there were only a few programs. And now I think I counted last night, like 38 neurologic physical therapy residency programs. So there's many more. So my experience was wonderful. It is a lot of hard work, a lot of time. And so, thinking about if a residency is right for you, this is a question that we get a lot. And the simple answer I would say is yes. If you are really excited about a certain area in physical therapy and you want to learn more and really just get fully, integrated into that world, I would say residency is a really good way to do it. There are some considerations though. So there are, you know, approximately, I think, 38 residencies now for neuro, but those are still in specific locations. So there isn't necessarily a residency associated with every PT school or in every city. So that is definitely one consideration. Is there one in your area? Or are there residencies in cities or locations that you'd be willing to move to for a year? So, I mean, that's a huge part of the equation, is accessibility. And is it something that you have access to and that would work for your life? The second thing that is really important to consider is, what is your end goal for doing the residency? What is your goal for your career? I have to say, when I did the residency, I did not have an answer to that question, so I wouldn't have been able to tell you. I knew I wanted to be a better clinician. I knew I needed to learn a lot still, and that's, I guess, how I feel now still, is that there's so much to learn. So I knew that a residency would help me feel more confident, really be exposed to even more research and mentoring. I would say I actually was interested in teaching. That's another component of the residency that I might have missed earlier at USC. So I was really interested in teaching, had taught previously or tutored and things like that, and so I was interested in that as well. So when looking at the different residencies and the options in terms of location, see, you know, what does that residency include? And are these things, you know, do you really want to do all of those things, or are you just interested in some mentorship and really progressing your clinical skills? Because what I'd like to say is I would highly recommend a residency, but if for some reason it's not right for your life, there are many ways that you can kind of build your own residency and get a lot of the same experiences and really progress your career in the same way that a residency does. So definitely that's a great question to ask in our Facebook group. If you're thinking about doing a residency and you know what you might be excited about learning or what your hesitations might be, we would love to chat with you about it and talk from our experience. In terms of the founders of the NeuroCollaborative, myself and Julie Hirschberg both did the residency at USC a few years apart. And then Erin did not do a residency, but she worked at Rancho Los Amigos, which is the site that USC is associated with. So some of the residents are at USC, some of the residents are at Rancho, and Rancho has a long history of excellent rehabilitation and physical therapy and mentoring and education and research. So if you work somewhere like that, it's practically like a residency. It's maybe just not formal. And so even though Erin didn't go through the actual residency program at USC, she got probably a lot of the same experiences while working at Rancho. And then our fourth founder, Sarah King, did not do a residency, and she really has just built this career and kind of taken her career where she wanted it to go. And that is something that really anybody can do as well. So we all are coming from different perspectives, and we'd love to answer your questions about residencies and what your thoughts are. Another thing to consider is when you do a residency. So I went and did the residency right after PT school, and ideally that is not what I would recommend. I think having the residency be your very first job out of PT school is not ideal. For one, you're just figuring out things like documentation and getting comfortable with patients and comfortable with your treatment. And so to have that be happening at the same time as the residency is pretty intense. Obviously it works. I made it through. I'm here. I survived. But I don't think it's the best. I think the best situation is to graduate from physical therapy school, work for a couple of years, get your feet wet, really see, you know, what area you're interested in. Maybe then you'll have a better understanding of things that you might like to do, like get involved with research or teaching. And then when you come into the residency, I think you will get a lot more out of it than if you do it directly after PT school. Unfortunately, the caveat to that is that typically with a residency, you're getting paid for the clinical hours that you work, so that's part-time rather than full-time, and maybe getting a stipend for teaching in a great situation, but in most cases, you will not be making the same amount of money as if you're working full-time somewhere. So that is definitely a consideration. I think for a lot of people, they leave and start working, and then it's really hard to go back to making less than full-time income, especially if you went to USC and have USC loans to pay off. So that's a consideration. These are all things to kind of weigh and figure out for yourself. I know somebody else, though, who graduated from a school in Chicago. She's actually originally from Orange County. She went to PT school in Chicago and worked for a few years there. And then she knew she wanted to move back to Southern California. And so she did that partially through doing the residency. You know, she could have moved back and just gotten a job. But definitely the network that you develop through your PT school and through your first few jobs is hugely important. And so once you start working, you realize that it's pretty hard to, you know, just move to a new location and make all those new contacts and feel like you have this really great work community. So a residency can be a really good way to move to a new city because you can make those new contacts and really, you know, get settled and feel like you have a lot of good resources in the area. So a little shout out to Carrie. I think Carrie would say that that worked out really well for her. She had some teaching experience and was interested in research. So everything that the residency involved was exciting to her. And then now she's working in Orange County. And that's, you know, we met through her doing the residency. And I think that's where she met a lot of her current colleagues and friends. So that can be a really good way to do it. So there's things to think about: location, timing, where you want to go with your career, what is your end goal, and if a residency really is right for you, then that is awesome. You know, then there's the application, interviews, and doing the residency, and if that's the path that you go on, I think you will be really happy you did. for all the hard work it was and the, you know, some of the stress of that year, the only reason I'm where I am now in terms of my career is because of doing that residency. The people that I met, the opportunities that I had, in the past 10 years, I would say it has been rare for me to really need to apply for a job. When I've been ready to try new things and do different things, I often have been offered a job or have, you know, the connections from the residency and from teaching really have helped me get my foot in the door at certain locations where I was interested in working. So it really can help in many, many ways. And I'm so glad I did the residency. The two physical therapists I did the residency with are still two of my best friends, and I respect them so much and what they're doing. It's really a great community to be a part of. So if you choose to do the residency, fantastic. If you realize that based on any of these factors, maybe location, maybe you live somewhere and you are settled there, your family is there, your life is there, but there is no residency. And so that is just not really an option. So what can you do to make your own residency and get some of the same experiences? So we talked about clinical experience. That's probably number one. So trying to get a job where you are get to work with people who have neurologic conditions. Or you could check out our video, How to Carve Out Your Neuro Niche in a Non-Neuro World. So let's say you have employment that you do not currently get to see a lot of people who have neurologic conditions. You could start to make that happen. So see which population in the area there is a need for. You know, who do you feel like you can really see well and accommodate in the clinic and the space you're working in, and just start carving out that niche. Then mentoring. Along with your clinical work, mentoring is the next big piece of that. So, you know, start to put the word out in your area and see, is there someone who owns a neuro clinic? Is there a hospital in your area that sees neurologic clients? You know, try to connect with someone locally to see, what if you went and spent some time with them in the clinic? Or is there any way that they could come spend some time with you in the clinic? That mentoring is really key. And trying to set that up on a consistent basis is huge. It'll really teach you how to self-reflect on your interventions. And then also, it's extremely important to get feedback from an outside source. You know, sometimes looking in and assessing ourselves can be a little intimidating, and sometimes we're not the best at it. So really getting feedback from someone and working closely with them. Another way you can do it is if you can videotape some of your treatments with people and then go and watch it yourself later and kind of be your own mentor. That's also a possibility. And if you haven't videotaped yourself doing an intervention, you definitely should. You will probably be surprised about something about what you do, maybe how much you talk or what you guys get through or something about the communication with the patient. So it's a really good way to learn without necessarily having to have that external source. But I would highly recommend finding a mentor. If you are trying in your community and you're having difficulty finding someone, that is the really cool thing now about social media, is there is so much mentoring available over the internet. So whether it's on Twitter, on Facebook, that is something that we're really looking forward to doing. And Julie already kind of loosely mentors a lot of new grads who are out there getting their new jobs and figuring out their path with NeuroPT. So that is something that we definitely want to offer too. So if you look in your local area and you're having a hard time finding a mentor, reach out to us, contact us. We can help figure out, you know, how to set something up, and maybe it's, you know, FaceTime or Skype or whatever session to talk about, like, what are you doing? What are your thoughts? What are your plans with people? What research and evidence are you using? And how are you moving things forward? Really, a lot can be accomplished through a video conference or chat with somebody. And that's something that now is just so readily available because of the internet that was different in my day 10 years ago. So let's see. So clinical time, mentoring, those are two really important things. And then some of the other experiences in the residency that are really wonderful. One is doing rounds or spending time with a neurologist. And this is definitely something that you can set up yourself. You know, see what neurology offices are in your area, contact them, and let them know, you know, this is something I'm interested in working with. I better keep track of in case there's any questions. Let's see. So contact your local neurologist and let them know, I'd like to come and spend some time in your office and learn and ideally collaborate at some point in time. You also will find that you can be a big help in the neurologist's office, because they often don't really know exactly what physical therapists do and how we do it, especially in the neuro population, what services we can offer, and sometimes even questions about insurance. You know, it's not their responsibility to understand how insurance and physical therapy work. So I've been in many offices where I can explain, you know, especially for people with Medicare, that they're how the caps work, and that definitely insurance will cover physical therapy, and it's just a matter of how much. But there is no reason not to go and have that initial evaluation, talk with a physical therapist, and get started on a program. So it's often really simple things like that that are a barrier for people from getting a referral at the neurologist's office to actually coming and seeing a physical therapist. So you can help a lot in those areas, but then also you will learn so much from spending time with a neurologist, watching their exam, hearing about how they treat, how they discuss prognoses. And then, of course, you're building that personal relationship with the neurologist, which is also a really valuable relationship to have and will you know, serve you for many years to come. The neurologist that I got to spend time with at USC still refer to me now down in Orange County when they see people. And so it makes me feel really good that they trust me and they, you know, respect what I do in terms of physical therapy. Then next, so we have our clinic, mentorship, spending time with the neurologist. Teaching is another area. If you're really interested in teaching, again, look in your area and see, is there a physical therapy or physical therapy assistant program in your area? My experience is that most programs are often looking for people to help teach, whether it's, you know, TA in the lab or come in to do lectures for certain topics. So that is something that you can definitely contact them and see what the need is and get involved in teaching. I don't think I've ever really heard of a program that doesn't need more help at different times. And that can be a really good way as well to build your network and spend time and get to teach if that's something you're interested in doing. Then there's education. So as part of the residency program, there's education that you participate in. And again, that's going to be a little bit different depending on the residency. But this is something you can do through APTA, the neuro section. You'll see that they do different courses like vestibular course and the Parkinson's course. They're teaching these around the country. And a lot of these are similar content to what is taught in residency programs and is developed by all the same faculty who are really involved in the APTA, who are also involved in residencies. So you could kind of plan out and say, okay, I'm going to take a year or two and I'm going to take a lot of continuing ed and really get that education to really progress your career forward as well. So you could look and see what's evolved through the Academy of Neurologic Physical Therapy, what else is available through APTA, check out some of the programs like USC who have residencies and see, you know, are some of the courses that they offer available for someone else to take. So there's just so many ways to get a good education. So, you know, just I think being a little strategic about it, look and see what all the different courses are that are available, what fits in your schedule, where you might be able to travel versus what courses are close. But there's more and more available. And then there also are even some courses online as well. I would definitely say for neuro, you want to go to the course, be, you know, there with people, practice those skills, interact. That's ideal. But there also are options online. And then lastly, being involved in research. So this is another area that I would guess a lot of people might feel kind of intimidated to participate. But again, I would say many universities in your area with a PT program may be running research studies. And often, for one, they need help recruiting participants for their studies. So if you have a population that you work with, you can collaborate with that university to say, you know, let me, what projects do you have going on right now? Who, what kind of people are you looking for? What would they need to do? And you can bring that to your clients and patients and let them know what research opportunities are available. A lot of times people are wary of research, especially if it's like, you know, medication or some other potentially invasive type of treatment. So maybe they have kind of steered clear of research, but for physical therapy and exercise interventions, a lot of people are very excited to participate. They often get, you know, a really good deal in terms of a certain number of sessions that's covered by the study. So they can really benefit from that. Sometimes there are also shorter term studies that are just looking at things like, you know, your verbal instructions to someone and how does that affect them while doing a balancing task. So there can be shorter and longer term commitments. So you can help facilitate that connection from the program to your clients, and then also you may be able to be involved in some way. So typically with studies, there is either a blinded evaluator or an intervention therapist. And I have, because of doing the residency at USC, after the residency, I worked on the LEAPS study, which is a locomotor experience applied post-stroke. And in that study, I was an intervention therapist. So we were doing treadmill training with people, body weight supported treadmill training, and then overground gait training. And then not a control group, but the other group was doing a home exercise program where we actually went to their homes and brought them through this whole exercise program that was progressive and challenging, but did not focus on gait and balance. So working as an intervention therapist, I really learned a lot. I think I have a much better ability to read research now and understand what's going on because of working on a research study. There also is less paperwork sometimes because a lot of the paperwork has been done ahead of time asking for the funds for this study. And then you really get to do the therapy, work in a structured setting, and of course document what you do. But it's a little bit less onerous than, let's say, Medicare paperwork. So that's kind of a pro in terms of working on studies. And then after working on that study, it wrapped up, it was done, and so I started working in a clinic again, and then I had the opportunity to work on the eye care study, which was looking at upper extremity recovery in individuals post-stroke, and for that I was a blinded evaluator. So in that case, it's a really flexible work schedule. You book the evaluations with the sites. This was a multi-site study, so I went around to 5 different sites in Southern California, and I would go do the assessments. And I really like testing and being detail-oriented, and as consistent as possible. And it was a really interesting project to work on as well. And that is work that is very flexible, and often studies have a hard time finding somebody who maybe has that kind of flexibility in their schedule or is interested in working on research. So definitely getting in touch with the local programs again, PT programs, PTA programs, potentially even maybe not a physical therapy program, sometimes kinesiology programs, or if there's a motor control, master's and PhD program locally, they'll be doing a lot of the same type of research. So there are just so many potential ways to get involved. With research also, there's another potential way to get involved is collaborating with your local neurologists. So along with just spending time with them and learning from them and collaborating, research studies are also another project that you can work on. Sometimes it may be a certain population. Maybe this neurologist specializes in focal dystonia or something like that, where there really isn't that much research out there. It's probably hard for them to find a therapist who really understands dystonia. So you can first start by just, you know, working with them, and then maybe develop some programs that are really helpful, and then you can write up a case study or submit a poster for a meeting. There's so many potential things that you can do, and kind of starting small like that and then potentially grow. I also worked on a study last year. It was actually through a pharmaceutical company, US World Meds, and I got to work on that study because of the residency and knowing Dr. Beth Fisher, who brought me on to help develop an intervention for a study that then was rolled out to 20 sites across the country and was looking at people and exercising, people with Parkinson's, either exercising in an on or off state and seeing, you know, which group had more benefit. Unfortunately, they ended up having a tough time recruiting enough people for this study, so they're kind of shifting focus now. But that study, in every area where there was a neurologist, they needed to have a physical therapist to provide this intervention. And it wasn't running through, you know, big universities at all of the sites. So that personal connection with a neurologist in your area may also lead to getting to work on a study in that way too. And you can just bring up that that's an interest area for you. And again, there's so much potential. So I think those are kind of the main areas. Let me look and see what questions, if we have any. Neurocollaborative, probably Julie agreed that 5 years in one in terms of your clinical practice and how quickly you move forward. There's also the Academy of Neurologic PT also has a mentorship program, so definitely check that out on their website. And Evidence in Motion has a neurological residency program that can be done in any location. So that's fantastic. It would be really interesting to see what all the details are for that program. I'm sure you can find that information online. So it looks like we don't have any questions other than that. If you're watching this video later, please post your questions on here. If there's any other, you know, details about a residency or any thoughts that you're having, I'm sure I didn't cover everything, although I've been talking for a while. That was supposed to be about half as long. But anyways, it's something that clearly I care a lot about. I really enjoyed the residency I did, and I would highly recommend it to anyone. But also knowing that it may not be the right choice for everyone, there's all these other ways that you can get involved and have a lot of the same experiences and learn a lot of the same things that you can through doing a full formal residency. And in terms of getting your NCS, your neurologic clinical specialist, if you do a residency program that's accredited, you're able to take sit for the NCS exam quickly, right after doing the residency and completing that program successfully. If you don't do a residency program, you're still able to sit for the exam. There are just certain requirements in terms of the hours that you need to have of working with the neurologic population. So that's the main requirement. So if you don't do a residency, typically it takes a little bit longer. But if you are working in a setting where you get to specialize and see a lot of people with neurologic conditions, it won't really take that long. And I would definitely want to time all these continuing education courses and other experiences with plans to sit for the NCS exam, because that will help you a lot with your studying. So I think I will call it a night then. I got one question via text from my husband, who was saying, you know, how to prepare for a residency interview. And I'm thinking, I'm not going to cover that topic tonight. But that would be a really good topic in the future, is just how to prepare for interviews in general, whether it's for a position or for a residency. I think that would be a really good topic to cover. So we will cover that in the future. So I'll wrap it up. Remember, go to iloveneuro.com, join our newsletter, join our closed Facebook group, Neuro Collaborative, and please post any questions or thoughts on this video. I really had fun talking about all this, and hopefully it didn't seem too much like I was rambling. All right, so I'm going to say goodnight then. Everybody have a great week. We made it through Monday, and I will see you soon. Thanks. Bye.